everyone, welcome to the Woolen Spinning Podcast. My name is Rachel, and I can be found pretty much everywhere as Wealth of Pearls. This is a hand spinning podcast where I talk mostly about my spins in progress, my hand spun knitting, and my finished spins. Occasionally, there's a tips and techniques segment where I show you something that I've been working on myself and some reflections about that particular technique. Recently, in episode 14, we had a segment about sampling and creating a spinner's control card. So if that's something that interests you, definitely head over there and check that out. I live just outside of Vancouver, British Columbia with my husband and our two kids under four, as well as our two golden retrievers named Charlie and Charlotte. And that is sort of a little bit about me. We have a Ravelry group. It is called the Wool and Spinning Podcast. So if you're having trouble Googling for it in the Ravelry group threads, try Wool Spinning Podcast and it should come up. I have a little bit of housekeeping today. I have some spins in progress. I have some hand spun knitting and I also have a finished spin, and that should bring us to the end of the show. This is episode 16 and it is the beginning of February of 2016. So I hope you enjoy the show and let's jump right in. For housekeeping, I have just a reminder. This is going to be the last reminder for the month of February to get your introduction into the introductions thread in the Ravelry group. You need to be a group member to win this giveaway. The reason why I used the introductions thread for this giveaway was because it's wonderful to be able to, as a podcaster, know sort of where people are coming from and what their interests are and they're a little bit about them, so that you can sort of look at your viewership and if you're, it's an audio podcast, of course, your listenership, and just have an idea of who you're talking to. It's just really great. So that's why I use the introductions thread. It's also why I haven't responded and said hello back to most people. It's because I'm trying to keep the chatter to a minimum. So get your introduction in. The giveaway is for a 1-year subscription to Ply magazine. So it's definitely worth it. I will be drawing at the end of the month. I will temporarily lock the thread and just so that I can draw a winner and announce it on the show, and then I will open it back up again and we'll do something else for the introductions thread at that point. So there's something else going on in the Ravelry group as well. Nina, who is NLA Fontaine on Instagram, and she is Fuzzy Love Knots on Ravelry. Nina is a lovely person. I met her back in July when I actually found her podcast. She had just bought an Ashford Joy, and she was talking about it on her podcast and her learning curve around spinning. So we started messaging back and forth and started to get to be friends. And she's an ex-Californian living in Santiago, Chile, which is close to my heart because we spent some time down in South America a couple of years ago and we just loved it, loved every minute of it. I'm dying to go back, particularly to Chile. And Nina has very graciously offered to sponsor a pattern giveaway in the group. So she's offered up 4 patterns, which is incredibly generous. She's a new blooming designer, so definitely go check her stuff out. So this giveaway thread, she lives in the Southern Hemisphere, and basically Chile is lovely basically all year round. They get very little rain. We were there in April, and I was wearing skirts the whole time with blouses, and my husband was in slacks, like lightweight linen slacks and dress shirts, because we were there for a business thing. So it was really lovely. In the evening, I would throw a shawl on, and that would be kind of it. So she designs mostly summer knitwear and stuff that sort of lends itself more to summer knitwear. I actually really want to knit a pair of socks that she just released. Anyway, so what we're chatting about in the giveaway thread is what you spin in the summer. So do you prep your fiber in the summer? Do you tend to sample in the summer? A big thing of wool in your lap doesn't sound very appealing in the hot, hot weeks of July. So come over and share what you would, what you tend to spin in the summer. And 3 winners will be entered for that giveaway. The fourth pattern is going to be a morale booster in the hashtag Zero to Hero 2016 spackle that's going also going on in the group. We are embarking on a year-long journey from the raw fiber, whether it's comb top or from the sheep, and you're processing your first fleece or roving, whatever your fiber choice is, all the way up through sampling and figuring out how you're going to spin a consistent yarn, all the way up to knitting, crocheting, weaving a finished object. So it's a year-long spackle that we're doing, so I thought it would be a wonderful morale booster. The other morale booster that we have in the spackle thread, so now I'm on to the Zero to Hero, is Maya, who won the Smith & New Fiber from the Goals and Aspirations giveaway last month, has offered a morale booster as sort of a pay it forward for the group in the Zero to Hero. She's participating in that spackle and offered a pattern worth up to $10. So I will be drawing for that. I think I'm going to wait to draw that maybe in March. So the morale booster from Nina will be, I will draw that winner. No, I'll draw that winner in March and I'll draw the winner for Maya in April. And that'll kind of keep us going into the spring. Because by then we're going to be really slogging away on just spinning. So yeah, keep the chatter going in that thread, in the Zero to Hero 2016 thread. And it's been really great to see everybody's projects. I think that is it for housekeeping. So thank you to Nina and thank you so much to Maya, because both of you, it was a surprise and I just really appreciated it. It's wonderful to pay it forward. So thanks, you guys. It's early in the morning here and I worked yesterday and I'm losing my voice. So I'm hoping I don't go all croaky like last time. but I'm drinking my coffee, so hopefully that'll be okay. Handspun knitting. I am going to insert a few photos here of what I'm working on for my handspun knitting, just so that you can kind of have an idea of what things look like. I'm working on three projects right now, which is really unusual for me. I usually only have one or two on the needles that are handspun. I usually only have one or two projects in general on the needles. I don't like having, I think I'm up to like 10 right now. I hate that. I am a very monogamous knitter. I tend to have socks and something else on the needles, and that's pretty much it. So I'll enter a couple photos here and you can see what I'm working on, and then I will talk about them. Okay, so the first thing that I thought I would show you is actually not in this bag. It is in this bag. There's going to be a bit of crinkling. I'll move it away from the mic. This is my vanilla shawl that I talked about last episode. I am knitting this with a dear friend of mine. She's one of my best friends. And we cast this on after a phone conversation on a Friday morning. Trying to figure out something simple for her to knit on a ferry for the next 2 hours. She is making amazing progress, and actually I wouldn't be surprised if by the time you see this in a few days, hers isn't actually done. She's doing hers out of Broco Ultra Alpaca, but mine is doing, I'm doing it out of handspun. So I'll hold it up to the camera and you can see what it looks like. It's very textured. There's a lot of marling and there's just a lot of marling and a lot of different texture going on in the stitches, and there's sparkle in here, and there's I'll tell you the fibers in just a minute, but this is basically what it looks like. It's getting huge. And you can see, so the fibers that the colors that I blended in the fiber is navy blue, sage green. There's some teal in here, but it's lost. You can't see it. And then there's white, which you can see right here, of course. And this like very interesting kind of gray color, and it's actually 100% silk that I threw in from something that I had bought at Fibers West about
9 years ago now. I bought it in 2007, so it's getting to be a long time. And the other color that's in here is a, it's, I was going to say it's an ochre yellow, but it's almost sort of more of a mustard yellow. I actually just spun a whole, my finished spin is actually in that color, so you'll see it later in the show. But you can see all of this marling and whatnot in the yarn. And this is what I hated, all this stuff in here. This is actually the part that I hated in the folded squares or folded paper, whatever that cardigan was called, that I was trying to explain to you last week or last time about. And it's just, there's all this marling in here. When I knit it in the garter stitch, it just looked really muddy and really messy, and I really didn't like it. And in the stockinette stitch, because it's, the stitches are just laying flat, and unfortunately I didn't wash and re-skein the yarn. I just ripped out the cardigan and started knitting, so my yarn is all kinked up, as you can see. And it's I just didn't bother washing it. So the stitches aren't laying perfectly flat, but that'll block out when I wash it and block it. And this is going to stretch quite a bit when I block it. It from a distance, because you would be seeing it from back here if I was wearing it, it's just so much more pleasant. There isn't all that texture going on, and there isn't all that stuff, and instead it just looks striped and like it is intended to be like that. And I think the beauty of that is that it becomes just completely about the yarn and about the texture of the yarn. So there is still striping, and I knew that there would be, but it's just a lot more pleasant and a lot more neutral, and it's just very plain. And like I said, it's just a very, very simple vanilla shawl. And this is the edge, and all I did was a 3-stitch garter tab with an increase on the right row, on the right side rows, and then the middle. Oh, sorry, dry throat. And then in the middle is my center stitch with an increase on either side for the rows. So it's a true triangular shawl. So when it's done, it'll be a huge triangle. I really wanted to show you what the yarn looked like and the other skein looked like before I wind it into a ball. So that you could get an idea of what this yarn is like. And I really want to show you sort of what the yarn looked like, because there's all this fire star in there and whatnot. So I really wanted you to see what the yarn looks like prior to knitting it up like this, so that you sort of have an idea of what textured yarn looks like before you start to knit with it. So I am going to pause the show here, and I'm going to go grab that skein, because I think I'm doing you a disservice to not see what it originally looked like. Okay, so this is what the yarn looked like originally. So I spun this from bats that I had made on my drum carder, and I threw merino, corriadil, perendil, silk, firestar, and silk, firestar, perendil, corriadil. What else did I throw on here? I think that's everything. So I got all of that marling and all of that barber polling that you can see in there. You can see how barber polled it is. And there's some sections where the yellow and the navy blue marl together. And in here. And that's why the garter stitch for me just was really not making it. I really didn't like what it looked like. And it's because I found that with the garter stitch, it was, if you can believe it, it was too much texture for that degree of barber pulling. And so when I'm knitting it up in just regular plain old stockinette stitch, I much prefer the results. This has been skeined for a long time. I made this yarn back in the summer, and I did talk about it on the show, because when it was first finished, I was so super stinking happy with it. I actually have another skein of this, but it's quite a bit smaller. It's what I would call more of like a typical skein. It was probably about 60 or 80 grams. I need to weigh it. I'm actually going to keep it for a teaching sample instead of including it in the shawl, because there's so much yarn here that I think with this skein, once this little ball is finished, which I'll probably finish today, it's going to be more than big enough. My goal is to make it big enough that if I wanted to, I could fold it and wear it like this. So I want it to be quite big. Like, I want to be able to fold the triangle in half. Yeah, and just be able to wrap it once around my neck, almost more like a kerchief for under my winter jacket, which is not a winter jacket, it's a rain jacket. But that's kind of my hope. So I'm just going to keep on knitting. And I made these bats when I was sort of thinking about doing an Etsy shop and was going to be selling bats and Rolags and punies and stuff. And I loved the bats so much, and the little nests of fiber that I broke the bats down and I put them into nests, and I was going to sell it as like a little bag of like nests. And my brother was over and he saw it sitting on the counter because I was going to start photographing it. And he was like, "What is that?" And so I was telling him, and he's like, "Well, how would that spin up? Like, that sounds really kind of like you've got all those textures and all those fibers in there. Like, I don't think that would work." And I was like, "Oh, let me show you." So I grabbed my drop spindle and I started spinning just a little sample for him. And he said, "Oh, that's really cool." Like, I could see he was kind of processing what I was saying and what I was showing him. But I was hooked. I was like, "Oh, I have to keep spinning this." So I actually did the rest of it on my Lendrum. I used a short forward draw and I did smooth it down. I didn't spin it woolen. I spun short forward draw. So I ended up with a worsted yarn from a woolen prep. So I call this yarn a semi-worsted yarn. It's not fully worsted because it wasn't a worsted preparation. But it's ended up being a little teeny tiny bit fuzzy. You guys probably can't see the little bit of fuzz back there, but there is a bit of a halo. And I do have sections. This was a huge learning thing for me. So for those of you who have drum carders and are starting to play with blending color, on my hand cards, I find it really easy to mix my Firestar in really, I find it just easier to blend my Firestar when I have hand cards. On the drum carder though, take a look at these, particularly the ones at the top. You can see at the top there that one of the plies is actually just Firestar. And that's because I didn't blend the Firestar well enough. So I actually like in the bat, and I'll show you the yarn that I finished. It's the same problem. I didn't break the Firestar down enough and blend it well enough, and then I didn't put it through the drum carder enough. So it creates a really interesting effect. But what happens in the actual physical knitting, let me see if I can find, I just knit it, like just, I actually have some sections where right in here where the yarn is actually only Firestar. That ply right there in there, that yarn in there I should say, is actually plied with Firestar, and it's just Firestar, which is kind of an interesting thing because the Firestar is so ropey compared to wool and compared to like fiber, because it's synthetic and it's man-made. So it's very odd in your yarn for it just to be, it's right there, for it just to be like, it's really hard to show you, but basically it's just completely different from the rest of the yarn when you have Firestar plied with Firestar. It actually kind of made me giggle a little bit because I was like, yeah, that I totally didn't blend that properly, and I know exactly what I did wrong. And it's just a matter of pulling the Firestar apart more and having smaller chunks of it going onto the drum carder with the fiber. So that was a really interesting learning thing for me. My other hand spun knitting are my cheviot socks. And of that yarn that I made from the bats, I actually have a 1,000 yards. So my original plan was to knit a sweater, and that's why I had started the Pearl Soho cardigan. So that's why I'm just going to keep knitting with the shawl, because I know I have just a huge amount. And I'm knitting that on 3.75 millimeter Chaogu lace needles, and which is a US size 5. And I got 1,000 yards, and my grist for that yarn was 1,400 yards per pound. So I spun just shy of a pound. I spun about 350 grams, roughly. It's 320 grams. So really good yardage, really light. So these are my cheviot socks, and I'm going to keep them back here because they, the colors are wrong otherwise, but these are what they look like. I have turned the heels. I'm using my 2.25 millimeter Chaogu lace needles as well. I think these are my lace needles. Yeah, lace needles. And these are US size 1s. I'm actually starting to get my US sizing. Did you notice? I'm on it. I'm actually starting to pay attention, because I'm noticing that some podcasters only give the metric, and then some podcasters only give UK sizing, and then some podcasters only give US sizing, and then some shows try to give all of the sizing. And I'm actually starting to find it quite helpful, because it kind of gives you she probably knits at approximately that gauge, and that's sort of like mine, and maybe that's a good place to start. So I'm going to try and start including the different needle sizes for you guys, because I think for hand spun it's kind of a crapshoot, excuse my language, of trying to figure out where to start with needle sizes. So just for reference points and whatnot, it's nice to share with one another what is working. So I do knit my socks quite tightly. This yarn is a 2-ply, as you know. This was my cheviot that I spun back at the very beginning of the year. And this is my ball. I've got a ton of it left. Nora has been asking for socks, which is kind of funny because she has no idea what that means. She turns 2 next month. She was complaining the other day that her feet were cold. And I said, well, do you want me to knit you some socks? And she said, yes, please, mommy. I was like, oh, okay. So if I have enough left over, I might actually knit her some tube socks, and I'll use this yarn and stripe it with some of my leftover Smith and UBFL that I have left over, and knit her like super, super long socks that come up over her knees, and then she can wear them for a really long time. So the only difference with these, this is the Fish Lips Kiss heel that I always do for my socks. It's my default for socks. I don't do anything else for the heel. I always knit my socks toe up, and I always do quite a rounded toe. So I do a Turkish cast on for the toe. So I cast on 14 stitches. And actually, it was quite funny at knitting night last week. A couple of people were complaining that they don't really like Judy's Magic Cast On. And I said, yeah, I'm not a big fan either. And I think for me, it's partly because I'm a continental knitter, and it's a bit too finicky for me. I have tried it, and I have done socks with it, but it's just not my favorite. And so I said, oh, I really like the Turkish cast on. So next thing I know, I had 3 ladies sitting with me wanting to learn how to do it. And it was really fun demoing it, because it is so simple. And they were all like, oh, like, thank you for showing us that. And they're all going to try it. And I'm going to demo it again later this month. So that was really fun. And then what I do is I increase to 26 stitches on either needle. So 52 stitches for my socks. My feet are quite small. I have size 7 feet. And so I only do a very short toe box, because I need the room in my toe box. My feet are quite boxy. So I increase quite quickly, and then I just knit straight. And actually, it's funny, because I've knit a lot of socks this fall and this winter, and every single pair of socks that I've knit for myself, from the increases up to where I need to start for the heel, it's 70 rows every single time. So I might just stop measuring and just start doing 70 rows and do the heel and move on. The only modification that I made was in the gusset this time, right before I got to turning the heel. I did increase on either side 4 stitches to give myself a little bit more room across the top of my foot, because I find that the heel for the Fish Lips Kiss heel just pulls the sock tightly enough around the back of my heel. Like it sits in here tightly enough and is, my heel has enough room because I have very small heels, but the top of my foot doesn't have room. So I thought, well, if I increase 4 stitches, that'll still work out for the ribbing, the 2x2 ribbing at the top of the sock. It'll give me a little bit more room for the calf if I want to knit them taller. And maybe it'll give me a better fit across the top of my, basically where my foot hinges. That's basically like where I needed more room. So this one that's knit a little bit, it's only about 1/2 inch taller than the other one from my heel. I actually pulled my lace, I pulled my needles through, and so that, this is very confusing. I pulled my needles through so that my loop was here at the, I don't want to lose my stitches, but basically like I pulled and I'm all tangled. I don't know why I'm all tangled. I never, my yarn, my needles never get tangled. Anyways, I pulled my needles through to here and then I tried them on and they fit really, really nicely. So I am hoping that this will be my new fix for this problem, for this particular problem with my, where my foot hinges. So I'll let you know how that goes. So those are my Cheviot socks. 2-ply, high twist. And when I say high twist, they're high twist. My yarn twists back on itself when I pull it out of the ball. I wanted it to twist back on itself about 2 to 3 times, and that's about what it does. I think that is all of the details about those socks. So hopefully next time they'll be finished. And then the only other thing that I'm working on is my succulent shawl. I haven't made any progress on this from last time. I've got the 3rd lace panel done, and that is all. I haven't actually worked on these because I'm working on something else for a yarn review, and I'm working on that monogamously right now, and I'm doing that for the hashtag craft for 20, which is a craft along that's going on in the Tiny Paper Foxes Ravelry group, and that's Tiny Paper Foxes is a podcast on YouTube, and her, Jenny and Devin are awesome, so definitely go check that out if you haven't watched that show. Jenny is a knitter and a sewer, and Devin is a knitter and a spinner, so they're a married couple. It's just a great show. So that is my succulent shawl. This was the yarn, and this is my 2-ply Polworth and silk. It was a Sweet Georgia braid originally, and then I over-dyed it. So that is my succulent shawl by Maria Monska, and Maria hosts the Stitched in Sweden podcast. And it's another great podcast, so you should go check that one out too. All these podcasts. I feel like right now there's just so many that it's hard to give a shout out to absolutely everybody because there's so many great podcasts out there. And actually the succulent shawl, there's quite a few people knitting it right now, which is really great. I have two dear friends named, one's named Julie and one's named Julia, and I always get them mixed up. And now there's another Julia in my life, and she hosts the Happy Knitting podcast, and she's a spinner and a knitter. She's in Germany, and she is doing the succulent shawl of her hand spun as well, and it is beautiful. So I'm really excited to see the difference between our two shawls and how they knit up, because I kettle dyed mine semi-solid, and hers is a little bit more, her yarn is a little bit, well, it's brighter for one thing. It's a gorgeous color, and then it's there's areas where it's ever so slightly marled and barber pulled, but it works in hers, whereas in my original one, it didn't work. And so I'm really excited to see hers and how it turns out. And it's kind of fun to be knitting along together because I'm watching her progress, and it's just kind of fun. Spins in progress. The first thing I was going to talk about really quickly, and this is for the hashtag Zero to Hero 2016 Spackle in the group. So this is where we're spinning and knitting along from our raw fiber all the way up to our finished object. So I am spinning away. I have this much to go for fiber for the first braid. No, that's not even the first braid. That's half of the first braid, and this is my bobbin thus far. So this is BFL in silk. This is in the Pacific Spirit colorway. This was my spinner's control card. This is all from episode 14 when I sampled this for you guys and showed you how I build this card. And this is my finished sample skein. I love this so much. So that is what it looked like in the end, and I just love it. It's a bit fuzzy. It's a two-ply. It's going to look great. And this is for the canopy shawl by Melody of the Mandarins podcast. I'm just dropping names all over the place today. And these are the little nests of fiber that I'm spinning from. And actually, I haven't worked on this week. And the reason for that, I worked on it last weekend, but I haven't worked on it since. And the reason is because I was really wanting to finish what I have finished. So I haven't made a lot of progress on that. And I'm hoping that by next week, I'll have some more progress. And that I might even be finished my first bobbin. So hopefully, fingers crossed. Sorry for the telephone ringing. I think my brother and sister-in-law are in town this weekend, so we've got a lot of family stuff going on. And I'm here podcasting with you guys. They'll laugh when they see that. They watch the show sometimes. The second thing that I'm working on is another project for the Zero to Hero. So my original plan, and I talked about this last show, was to do my Clun Forest and the Pacific Spirit BFL and silk for the Zero to Hero spackle. And I haven't scrapped the Clun Forest, but I have decided not to put another big spin on my wheel. And the reason for that is because I've just started teaching, and I'm teaching at the Sweet Georgie Yarn Studio. And that's, as I expected, a huge learning curve. And I've been spending quite a bit of time on my prep for that and for teaching and for being in the classroom. Because it's sort of a workshop style, but it's quite intense. So I decided not to start any other big projects right now, just to take some things off my plate. So I decided instead that my Spin the Bin challenge, which was all of this Falkland that I have and that I've been working on for the Shackleton Cal over in the FiberTrek TV podcast group, that I would finish this instead. So this is part of my Spin the Bin, which is going on over in the Completely Twisted and Arbitrary Ravelry group. And I have I have these two bumps to go. They're both just shy of 2 ounces. And I have, I think, two more of these. So I still actually have quite a bit to go. So I have this too. I'm getting really sick of this. It's spinning up really fast. I actually got an entire bobbin done at Knit Night last week. Well, not an entire bobbin, but pretty close. This was empty when I got to Knit Night, and this is what I got done that night. So that's really good. This is what it looks like up close. You can see all of the naps and all the color in there and everything. I'm going to be totally honest. I am not enjoying spinning this at all. I have ended up, after sampling it a little bit and working on it at the beginning, sorry about that, the bobbin fell over. These were my two original bobbins that I still need to finish and, holy Hannah, sorry guys, finish and get ply, and I'm going to fill these back up and then I'll ply them with my other two bobbins that I've got going right now, because one of them is actually on my match list and it's finished, it just needs to be pulled off. It's a very roundabout way of telling you that I don't like this and I'm not enjoying it. And the reason is because when you look at the fiber, see if I can find a section that's particularly bad. This is where, and I'm going to save some of this for when I'm talking to students and one-on-one with beginning spinners. When you look at this fiber from here, it looks fine. It's carded, it's roving, there's nothing really inherently wrong with it. But when you start pulling it apart a little bit and you start really looking at it. And I'll see if I can find the section that's particularly bad. I'm just really hoping this shows up on the camera because this is sort of one of those like buyer beware situations where I don't regret buying this, but I don't think I would buy it again. I definitely wouldn't buy it again, but if I was in the situation again, I maybe wouldn't buy it knowing what I know now. So let's get the camera to focus. And then can you see in there all those naps? Right at the top there, right behind my face, right in front of my face, all those naps. So now when you look at the fiber, it's not quite as pretty. So all those naps are from when it was on the drum carter. The Falkland would have been pulled on the tines. The tines are the pins that make up hand cards, drum cards, and blending boards. And it would have sprung back under tension. So it would have been on the tine under tension and it springs back and it gets all tangled and that's what creates naps. This fiber is chocker block. And when I bought it, I knew that it had naps in it, and she actually sold me some extra to account for the naps. And I think it's going to make the sample that I knit up and the sample that I spun up is very, it looks very tweedy. And I think in a knit fabric, it will look really great. But when you're spinning it, it's just frustrating because you've constantly got these naps going by you. And when you're spinning woolen, any inconsistencies and any kind of stuff that you see going past you, somehow you sort of have to relinquish control and just let it go. And and know that it's going to be fixed when you ply the yarn and when you finish the yarn. And in this case, it's really hard to let it go because I don't know if those naps are going to be okay in the yarn and if they're going to be finished okay and if they're going to hold up to knitting and wearing a sweater in this yarn. So this is all unknown. And it's making the spinning a wee bit tense because I don't know. And I'm putting a lot of time and a lot of effort into it. I'm not going to scrap it. I'm not going to just put it aside just because I'm not sure. But I'm very aware that the sweater may not be able to endure heavy wear. I am making a 3-ply to increase the durability of it. Just so that the 3-plies, generally woolen spun yarns are generally 2-plies, just because they're airier, and so the more plies you add, the bulkier woolen yarns can get. So I am spinning my singles quite fine. And I'm just really hoping, you can see that against my face, I'm just really hoping that the 3-ply will add a little bit of durability and strength. I'm also actually spinning it quite high twist now compared to my initial. I'm going to throw my original skeins that are already finished, I'm going to throw them back through the wheel one more time to just tighten them up a little bit because the little bit of extra twist will help a lot too. So that is the second thing that I'm working on. My new rule is that before I start any new projects, I have to finish a bobbin of this. So that's why I have two bobbins finished, because one of them was before I started the spin that I finished, and the other bobbin was before I went on to work on my Pacific Spirit. So that's actually working quite well. That's why I have two more bobbins done. The only thing that doesn't include is the Sweet Georgia Club, because that's a deadline. So it's obligation spinning, and I don't want to risk not having that done because I'm working on my Falkland. So yeah, I'm spinning it long backwards draw, double drive on my matchless, and at a ratio of 22.5:1. And the reason why I'm using such a high ratio is because I'm pinching and drawing back 2 inches, not that far, but 2 inches, open it, let the twist run in, pinch, pull back another 2 inches, open, let the twist run in, pull back 2 inches, and then wind on. So over those 2 inches of, over the 2 inches of drafting, so that where your fiber becomes yarn, there's roughly 10 or 11 twists in those singles. So it'll be, that'll match sort of what Falkland can manage as in terms of crimps per inch. Falkland is very similar to Polworth, merino. Some people call it Falkland Islands merino. So that's not entirely accurate because Falkland is a blend, but the original sheep, like the bulk of what makes up Falkland, is merino. So two inches and having that 22.5 twist per inch, 22.5 ratio distributed over 2 inches is sort of the right twist for what I sampled in the yarn. That sort of feels right. So, and looks, is making yarn that I like. The last thing that I'm working on is my Sweet Georgia Club. So for those of you who don't want to see the reveal, just fast forward a little bit, but I'm not going to show the braid and I'm not going to talk about what the fiber content is. I'm just going to show a little bit of sampling because I'm really torn about how to spin this month. So I actually threw it on my drum carder and I blended all of the colors together, and this is just a little bit of it. And so it's all blended together and all the colors are kind of blended. And the pinks in this month's when I did this, and the purple, kind of it got lost when I did this. So I'm not going to do any more of it like this. And my problem with this month's is that it is superwash. Not that it's superwash, me and Felicia had sort of hoped to do a singles yarn, but I'm always really leery to do singles and superwash. So this is my singles sample. And I really like what it looks like, but I'm not sure what I would do with it. And it does seem quite strong. After I washed it, this is washed. So, and it's actually a bit sprongy and a bit bouncy, and I actually quite like it. So I might spin the rest of the braid as a singles. I'm just really worried about strength and, strength, because it's superwash. But there are tons and tons of superwash merino yarns on the market right now that are all superwash. So maybe the whole superwash singles thing is not really so much of a thing, and I've just kind of got it in my head that it's a thing. But I've had disasters in the past leaving superwash yarns as singles yarns. So I'm kind of torn. So that's my single sample. And because I did it on the drum carder, the colors are all heathered together. And I mean, it's pretty, but I kind of want to preserve the original colors in the braid. And when I show you at the end of the month, you'll understand why. And then I took half of those singles and I two-plied them. So this is my two-ply sample. And I really like that. It's really pretty. It's balanced. It's very pleasing. But the singles yarn is definitely very enticing. I don't spin a lot of singles, but I really love singles. So, and I really love singles yarn. So it is something that I'm always very tempted by, and then I always end up plying. And I want to try and get away from that. So this is my Hanson bobbin. This was my superwash wool that I've been working on at the kitchen counter. I dyed this back in November. It's just a speckle dye. It was super generic superwash wool from Louette. They don't carry it anymore. I tried to find it on the website. They're carrying superwash merino now. But this was quite lovely to spin. It's very bouncy and very sprungy. It feels a bit chalky, like a downbreed, but it's superwash. So I wonder if it's the superwash that's done that. And this is my finished first bobbin. So I finished that last night, and I'm hoping to have the second bobbin started in the next couple of weeks. I have to get a few other things done, so this might end up languishing a little bit, but I'll start breaking down those other two bumps, or one of those other two bumps, and get my next bobbin on the Hanson, and then I'll have it ready to go, and it just sits there on the kitchen counter next to where I do our prep for dinner. And usually I get about 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day on it. And it's amazing how quickly you can spin when you've got 5 or 10 minutes. I'm spinning that at 40 wraps per inch. I'm going to do a 3-ply. There'll be socks for myself. Nothing special, but I'm really enjoying it. And that I'm spinning with a short backward draw. Short backwards draw for me for worsted spinning is my default. If I want to spin my default yarn, I Like two ply, short backwards draft, and I make a sport weight. That's like my default. So every time I spin sock yarn, I tend to do a short backwards draw, and I tend to, if I'm going to do a two ply, I tend to strip my braid a little bit more so that I get a fingering weight versus a sport weight. And if I want a sport weight yarn, then I tend to strip it a bit less, and then I get my default sport weight yarn. So that's sort of how I do that. The last thing that I'm going to talk about is my finished spin. This was my core. This is Knit Picks palette. I used two balls of this. This is all that is left from my second ball. Knit Picks palette is spun. The singles are spun clockwise, which is Z twist, and they are plied counterclockwise, which is S twist. So when you look at the twist there, if I were to tighten that up, so spinning it even more S twist. Now, how can I hold this so you can see? It just gets tighter. So you spin it more and more and more S twist, and it just gets tighter and tighter and tighter and tighter. You can see how if I do that, it gets tighter. And if I spin it Z twist, which is clockwise, it gets lighter and lighter and lighter, and it unplies it. So knowing that, it's still on the bobbin. I spun 4 ounces of core spin, core spun. So I spun this S twist, and the reason that I did that is because I wanted to add more twist to the Knit Picks palette. So I wanted it to be stronger of a core as I added twist to it. And I wanted, and I find now that I've spun a bit of core spun, and I've spun a few yarns, for me personally, it is more natural to spin my core spun S twist. Now talking, like I had said earlier about the blending of the Firestar, that right there, those three or four wraps, that is where the Firestar was not blended properly. And I have this three or four wraps around my bobbin that are just pure Firestar. Which will make really interesting yarn. I'm not worried about it at all. And then down here, I've got some Corriedale, that gray taupe color. It's a natural brown. I have some 100% silk in here. This down here is where the Firestar was much more properly blended on my drum carder. So I had two 2-ounce bats, and I divided each bat. I just kept stripping down. So I would just, I had the bat out, and I just kept pulling strips off of it. And then I would core spin them, and then I would pull off the next strip, and I would core spin it, and I would next strip, core spin. And I really love how this turns out. I'm looking forward to pulling this off and putting it on my Nitty Naughty and skeining it and getting it finished. This is for a gallery show that our guild is putting on in early 2017, but all of our stuff needs to be done earlier than that. And I really wanted to get it done early and get the base yarn done, because we're doing the ABCs of Fiber Arts, and I'm doing C for core spun, but I also kind of want to do C for coils and add, this is actually why it's still on the bobbin. I might actually pull some of this and do like 3 or 4 yards of coils with this. And then I also want to do something knitted. So just to show like what you can do with this yarn. And this is my jumbo bobbin from my jumbo flyer from the Lendrum. So that's what that, it holds a full 4 ounces. This is actually more than 4 ounces, because remember I have the core. And I think I have spun, this is well over 400 yards. I think it might even be well over 600. I'm pretty sure that I have put a full 8 ounces on this jumbo bobbin before when I've been plying. So I actually really want to get another one of these bobbins. Well, actually, full disclosure, I'd really like to get two more so that I have three, because the ratios on this flyer, a lot of people don't like their jumbo flyer on their Lendrum. They find it rickety, and they find it, it wobbles the wheel if you start going really super fast. This is what it looks like. It's ginormous. And while I agree, it does get wobbly, and when you're plying and you're trying to put a lot of ply twist in, like I don't ply my sock yarns on here. But for other things, this has a place. And one of those things is art yarns, because look at that orifice. It is huge. I just put my finger right through it. It's ginormous. So you can pretty much get everything through here for art yarn and textured yarn that you want to get through here. The other thing I really like about it is it's actually quite lightweight. It's there's no like bulk behind it. And the other thing is the ratios. So this up here, the biggest one is 5 to 1, which is just awesome. Because it's very rare to get a ratio higher than about 7 or 6 on a wheel. So getting down to like 3 to 1, 4 to 1, 5 to 1, it's nice to have that in your repertoire of ratios. The next one is 7 to 1, which is a very, it's a great ratio to have if you're applying BFL, Corriedale, anything that's longer stapled that doesn't need as much twist. And then your the smallest one on here is 9 to 1, and that is the one that I use when I ply. So that unfortunately is the one where if you want a higher twist yarn, so if you're wanting to put like 11 or 12 twists per inch in your yarn because you're applying like Polworth or Falkland or Merino, this one has to work quite hard. So you can imagine all of this bulk turning on your wheel on this huge, very sturdy maiden, but it's still like, it's a lot to get it to go around like that, and it wobbles. It just does. It's a lot of bulk, it's a lot of weight, and it's literally turning. And it's heavy. And the more yarn you put on your bobbin, it's heavy, and the bobbins are heavy. So like, it's not a great flyer to ply on when you're plying with yarns that need more twist. Not because you're making higher twist yarn necessarily, just because they're yarns that when you're plying need more twist than 9 to 1. A trick though that has really helped me and has increased the versatility of this flyer for me was something that I learned on I think it was on Spin, on this one of the Spin Tech. It was definitely on Ravelry on one of the forums, but I think it was on Spin Tech or one of the technical forums. So at the back here, you've got your Scotch tension, because Lendrum only does Scotch tension. It's a Scotch tension only wheel. So the traditional way of doing your Scotch tension is to wrap your brake band around like that, right? And then here's your tension knob here, and you've got your elastic band on this side to tension it. This pops up into place and you're good to go. So something that somebody had written, maybe it was on one of the Lendrum group sites, because there's two Lendrum groups on Ravelry, the Cult of Lendrum and Lendrum Love. Somebody had written in it with a very technical explanation about this, and I'm going to give you the like Cole's Notes version, because it was really interesting to read it, but if you don't have a physics background, it makes no sense. So basically what he recommended was, instead of putting it on the traditional way, one way to reduce the wobble and also take some of the tension off of your tensioning knob so that your bobbin can move more freely while you're plying. Because the more you weigh this down, the more drag you've got on your wheel and the more difficult it is to treadle, right? And you can do this on any wheel that does Scotch tension. This isn't just the Lendrum, it's just for the jumbo bobbin. It tends to be just an awesome thing to know, is take your brake band and turn it so that you twist it once and then put your brake band around. Just let me give myself a little bit more length. So you see how now it's twisted? Just once. Anything more and you won't be able to, it won't work. But when you do that, you're actually creating more surface area that your brake band is touching your bobbin. This is something that might work on the Hansen, and I haven't tried it yet, but I'm going to play with it, because when you have a higher surface area that your brake band is touching your bobbin, the brake and the amount of pressure that it's applying to create that brake is more evenly distributed. I mean, the ideal brake band would be one that actually goes almost like pretty much all the way around. But the nice thing about that is you can actually release a lot of your tension and you can have a much looser your brake band can be a lot looser while still exerting the same amount of brake, quote unquote, that you would if it wasn't twisted. And I find that that simple modification when I'm spinning, when I'm plying particularly, has made this flyer a pleasure to use. And I actually leave my jumbo flyer drive band, because it's a different size on the Lendrum. You have two drive bands when you get your Lendrum. I have actually found that it has increased the usability of this flyer to the extent that I leave that drive band on now. I don't take it off. And usually my brake band is about that tight. Like, it's very loose when I go to use it. And it's just that additional surface area that the brake applies that allows that distribution of that brake to be distributed over the bobbin. And that means you can release that pressure on there, and it does reduce some of the wobble. It's just a little bit more stable. So I hope that is just a little tip. If you're struggling with jumbo flyers and the weight of them and just making your wheel wobbly and creating not a great spinning experience, add that little twist in your brake band and just play with it and see if it works, because maybe that for you will increase the versatility of your wheel. I dropped it before, so I don't want to drop it again. I'm really like butterfingery these days. I don't know what's going on with me. So that is finished. It'll be skeined next show and it'll be washed, and I'll show you if I ended up doing the coils or not. So show notes for the episode can be found at wellforpearls.com. If you would like to join in the conversation at the Ravelry group, it is the Woolen Spinning Podcast group on Ravelry, and I can be found on Instagram, Twitter, and Ravelry as Wellford Pearls. I never mention this and I never talk about it in the shows, but I am a Craftsy affiliate. Any clicks on the banners on the website directly support the show. So things like shipping, download costs, recording equipment, any of that kind of stuff. So I really appreciate those clicks. Thank you so much. And until next time, happy spinning.